ladies and gentlemen, I'm TWK of TWK Reviews, and today we're talking about The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask, released for the Nintendo 64 back in the year 2000! In the year 2000! But before we get to that, hey, thank you to all my Plus Ultra patrons over at patreon.com/TWKReviews! Now, to talk properly about this, one of my favorite video games of all time, a video game that I spent more time with growing up than any other video game ever created, ever, ever, ever! Let's get straight to it, shall we? Where do I even start with this game? Alright, the basic premise, as that seems to have people quite divided about this game, albeit not quite as much nowadays, but that is the power of time for you. So, Link is out searching for Navi when a Skull Kid mugs him and is chased off to the wonderful world of Termina. During his time here, Link has 3 days to stop the Skull Kid before the literal moon crashes into Clock Town, aka the main hub of the game, and thus ending everything, so no pressure, dude! This isn't just a game with a hard 72-hour time limit, you actually have the ability to control time, to a degree. So I guess that makes Link similar to a Time Lord? What you can do is slow down time to 1/3 of its speed, warp to the next 12-hour cycle, and reset time to the first day. This gives Majora's Mask so much replay value, as you're able to replay almost any scenario without having to start up a new save file, which may not seem like that much of a big deal, but think of it like this. If you found a few specific side quests that you enjoy playing through, like fighting aliens on a ranch in the middle of the night, being a band leader and causing baby chicks to instantaneously grow up, or the entirety of the Anchoan Cafe questline, then you can redo them to your heart's content without the hassle of starting a new file and playing through the game's dungeons! Yeah, I know I'm practically on an island here, but I've never really cared for dungeons in most games, especially Zelda games. And it's nothing against them, but I've always been infinitely more interested in the side quests and minigames than anything a Zelda dungeon has offered me. I suppose this is why I prefer literally every 3D Zelda game over Twilight Princess, and yes, that does indeed include the divisive Skyward Sword. On the topic of side quests, specifically Anjou Cafe, there are quite a few tidbits of info you may not be aware of, so consider this a guide of some sort? Anyways, the first is that you can glitch your way into Sakon, however you pronounce his name's hideout, without having to wait for him to show up. This is unfortunately exclusive to the original version, so not doable on the 3DS remake, and I tried, believe me, I tried, but they patched this one out. Why? Another one is that you don't have to press any of the red panels during the puzzle section. Despite what seems to be every YouTuber doing this, anyways, you can move the blocks in a way that avoids them. I'm kind of surprised that no one, or at least no one that I've seen anyways, has figured this out. It's so frustrating to me, and yeah, I know it's a personal nitpick, but I doubt you watch these videos for professional opinions. And finally, there's a huge misconception. You actually don't have to wait until 10 p.m. to deliver the priority mail to Madame Aroma. As soon as nightfall hits, you can have the letter delivered either by yourself or the postman. I honestly blame bad strategy guides for spreading this around. It wouldn't surprise me if Primo was one of them, because I remember quite a few inaccuracies in their Majora's Mask guide, and I'd love to one day go through it to point out each one someday. On a tangentially related note, I was able to beat the postman's 10-second challenge without the bunny hood, albeit it took quite the number of tries, but I did it! As for the minigames, hoo boy, there are quite a few, so let's go over some of the more memorable ones, at least memorable for me. I must stress, this entire video is opinion-based, despite what some may think. First off is the treasure chest shop, and man, do I have a hate-on for this one. It's literally a randomized maze that you can't even see until a segment rises from the floor. 100% luck-based, with absolutely no way to tip the odds in your favor. Next is the Clock Down Archery Range. Just hit the red Octoroks and avoid the blue ones, as they'll deduct time, which sounds simple enough until you realize that, oh yeah, you're doing first-person controls with an N64 controller with a strict time limit. Now, to be fair, the controls are better than what you'd expect, but it's still super difficult to get a perfect score. Not impossible, but very, very difficult. Stepping outside of Clocktown, we've got some racing. First is with the Gorons, and if you don't like cheap AI, then you're going to wish this minigame never existed, especially since you need the prize in order to upgrade your sword. The biggest hurdle comes from your limited magic meter, and yes, I know you can get an extension, but I loathe dungeons enough already, so I'll be danged if I'm going to lollygag around them looking for collectibles. Nevertheless, actually winning a Goron race was quite exhilarating. This same could not be said for the horse racing minigame where you go up against the Gorman brothers. The AI is actually more tolerable here, but it costs money to play, and your only prize, after getting the Garo mask anyways, is milk, which you can get for free from the neighboring ranch, so it's all pointless! Something that is slightly less pointless is quote-unquote racing against the Beaver Bros. Now I say race, but it's more of a time trial, as all you have to do is go through all the rings within the specified time limit. Thanks to the oh-so-amazing swimming controls, no really, these are some of the best swimming controls I've ever experienced in any video game ever, clearing this one is an absolute breeze. It's a shame that this is one of the remake's biggest blunders. Not sure how they screwed this one up, but they did! One huge improvement to this game that does not get brought up enough is the decision to have every area be a fully rendered 3D room. Unlike Ocarina of Time, as far as I can tell, there are no pre-rendered 2D pictures used in substitution for 3D rooms, which is a much bigger milestone than it may seem. Just to put this into perspective, Final Fantasy IX was still using 2D pictures as backgrounds. Nothing gets that game, in fact it's one of my favorites, but this just showcases the work the developers put into Majora's Mask, and remember, this game was made in under 2 years! Now some of my favorite areas include the observatory, the milk bar, and inside the clock tower itself. Also a shout out to the inside of the friggin' moon. Man, I love how just tranquil it looks. Such a great peaceful atmosphere juxtaposed with the creepy children. Of course, there are countless other areas I could name, but whenever I think of Majora's Mask, I mostly think of these places. Another great thing about this game is that it will teach you. What, you may ask? First of all, you will learn to be patient. Unlike the 3DS remake, you cannot fast forward to any hour you want, so there will be times where all you can do is just wait, and wait, and wait, and wait. It's because of this game that I can literally wait around for ages and not be bothered. That is, unless I have something scheduled. Hey, another life lesson! Majora's Mask literally taught me how to properly keep a schedule thanks to its easy-to-read clock on the lower third of the screen and the handy Bomber's Notebook, which keeps track of pretty much every scheduled event the game has. Thanks to this, I'm always at least 15 minutes early to every place I need to be, as long as traffic isn't being a jerk. The most important lesson this game has to teach is easily the hardest that any of us have had to learn, and that's the importance of letting go. You see, this entire game's plot is kickstarted by two major partings. For Link, it's Navi, and for the Skull Kid, it's the four giants that act as guardians for Termina. Neither Link nor Skull Kid could accept these partings, and thus we end up on this adventure. In the end, both must accept that one day partings will happen. No relationship is forever, and it's best to enjoy the time that you have. That, to me, is why this game contains these stages of grief. Not for Link to accept his own death, as many commentators have hypothesized, but to accept that he may never see his friend Navi ever again, and that's okay. The Happy Mask Salesman actually put it best at the end of the game, so I'll let him take it from here. And that's The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask. It's an absolutely beautiful game, filled to the brim with entertaining side quests, fun minigames, and more symbolism than any one YouTube critic can handle in a single video. It's for all these reasons and more why it's my favorite in the entire franchise, and yeah, the 3DS remake is far from perfect, but I still can't help but love it. There really are a few games that hit me in the feel as hard as this one does, with those being Life is Strange, check out my Let's Play of it if you haven't already, Persona 5, and believe it or not, Super Paper Mario. So to all the developers that worked on this game, thank you for creating something that would shape me into the person that I am today. Looking into the development history of Majora's Mask, I know that making it was far from an easy task, and I appreciate every bit of effort they put into this game. Next time, we're doing something related to the world of wrestling, so I hope you'll join me for that.